What's up, world, and welcome to NuxTux Entertainment. My name is Jonathan, and I'll be your host for this Blender tutorial series. In today's video, I'll be going over Blender add-ons. I'll be showing you where you can download them, how to install them, and how to enable them. Also, I'll be showing you how to remove them. The main focus will be around Blender add-ons related to the sequencer editor. Also, by the end of this video, I'll be referring you to one particular add-on that I won't be going over in this video, but I will give you the link to it and show you the website. Now, to download them, it all starts with Blender. All you need to do is to go into Files, down to User Preferences, switch over to the Add-ons tab, and basically with any one of these add-ons, simply click here on the arrow to expand it, and then click on Documentation. This should open your web browser and take you to the extension's website. Now, simply go back to the scripts up here on the left, click on the plus sign to expand it. You get the different categories of add-ons: animation, camera, development, game engine, import/export. You also get their different status from released, contrib, and external. Down here we have the sequencer. Click on the plus sign to expand it, and then we can start with the Kino Raw tools. As we can see here, Blender 2.79 already includes the Kino Raw tool. So if you're using an earlier version of Blender, you might as well download it. So we've clicked on the link, and once we're here, this is GitHub. Here we can simply scroll down a bit, down to the download zip file here. Click on this link. Again, Blender 2.79 already comes with Kino Raw tool available to you in the add-ons. If you're using an earlier version, you can go ahead and download it by clicking on the clone or download and downloading the zip file. Otherwise, let's proceed. We're going to scroll down here at the bottom where it says external add-ons. We're going to download the VSC Transform tool and the VSC Quick Functions. By clicking on these links, we're taken to blenderartist.org. Scroll down. Here you get a quick overview of the keyboard shortcuts. We're going to click on this link over here, which is going to take us back to GitHub, and we can now clone or download zip. If you scroll down a bit, you also get the shortcuts right here. We're now going to download the VSC Quick Functions. As you can see, it also took us to blenderartist.org. We're going to scroll down here to the wiki, and it takes us back to the Blender script page. We can now download the VSC Quick Functions. I would recommend putting all of your add-ons inside of one particular folder, either inside of a Dropbox folder or OneDrive folder or your Documents folder, whichever, but make sure to have them all in one place. Now, if you scroll down here, you get all of the different functions that this add-on offers. As you can see, there are quite a few here. You can read about each of them right here. Once you've downloaded your add-ons, go back into Blender, and down here on the left, you have the Install Add-ons from File. But before we can do that, you'll first need to extract the add-ons. To do so, let's simply go to where we've downloaded the add-ons. Once you've made your way to the folder where you've downloaded the add-ons, simply extract them. The files that we're interested in are these right here, the Python files. Now we can go back into Blender, the User Preferences, and click on Install Add-ons from File. Make your way to where you've extracted your add-ons and select the PY file, Python file. I've already installed these, so if I click on Install from File, you'll notice I'll get a little warning up here letting me know that I've already installed this. So once you've installed your add-ons, you can go to User to see the add-ons that you've installed yourself.
Now, before we start enabling the add-ons, let's make our way to Files, and you want to make sure that you turn on auto-run Python script. I would like to point out that any changes that you've made to the user preferences will not be saved next time that you start up Blender unless you click on Save User Settings. If you don't do that, everything you've changed here will disappear as soon as you close this session of Blender.
By clicking on this small arrow right here, you can expand and see some basic information concerning the add-on. You can also remove the add-ons that you've installed by clicking right here on the Remove. You can report a bug or see the documentation of this add-on. Typically, this takes you to a website. We're gonna go down here to Sequencer, and here we have the add-ons that are in relation to the sequencer. As I said, the Kino Raw tool comes with Blender 2.79. If you're using an earlier version of Blender, simply download the Kino Raw tool, extract it, and install it the same way that we've installed the VSE Quick Functions and the VSE Transform tool. Alright, now let's have a quick look at what these add-ons do. I'll start with the simpler one, which would be the VSE Transform tool, which I find to be one of the most useful add-ons that I've been introduced to in Blender. Here is a clip of what I was able to accomplish using this add-on. Note that none of this was done using 3D viewport or anything. This was all done directly in the sequencer, with these elements having been created using Inkscape or GIMP. Then all I had to do was import them, and I was able to control them as you see. Now let's have a look at what this add-on allows you to do. Here I have one of the projects that I've worked on, which is an upcoming tutorial. Now, what this add-on allows you to do, first of all, to use it, you can go ahead and press the T key, which will add a transform strip. Now, this transform strip allows you to manipulate this sequence right here directly from the preview part. What I mean by that is, if we choose this sequence over here and look on this properties panel, move down to input, you can see here that you can offset the image, move it left or right, up or down, or you can even crop it. In order to scale it, you'd have to add a transform strip. Well, what this add-on allows you to do is pretty much skip all of these manual menus in a way, and allows you to control this sequence directly from the preview window. With our transform strip selected, simply place your mouse cursor over the preview area, and now with the G key, you can grab this image. With the R key, you can rotate this image. With the S key, you can scale this image. And with the Q key, you can control the opacity of this image. Now, if you'd like to reset all of these, simply hold down the Alt button and press the R key to reset the rotation, G to reset the position, S to reset the scale, and Q to reset the opacity. You can also set keyframes simply by pressing the I button, and keyframing either the location, rotation, scale, all three of them all together, even the alpha. You can also control your pivot point for the rotation by choosing the pivot point right here. Could be the 2D cursor, which you control by holding down control and clicking. In my case, it's right clicking, and you can rotate right here from the 3D cursor, also scale. And you can interchange this as you're going along, as you can see. This is it for the VSC transform tool. Also, it hides the original layer, so if ever you delete it and don't see your original layer, it's only hidden, made invisible. Moving on to the VSC quick functions. Now, this one is a bit more complex and offers a few more options. Here you can see the shortcuts that it offers, which are the S, F, Z, Control P, Shift P, Alt M, and Alt K. You'll notice that I've disabled some of them, which are features that I do not use. Now, to demonstrate quickly some of the things that you can do with it, let's go back to Blender, and down here in View, you get this new option here, which is Enable Quick Continuous. By enabling this, going back to View, you now get this new drop-down, Quick Continuous Settings. As you can see here, we have Auto Parrot New Audio to Video, which means that since I had this enabled when I imported this clip here, if I grab just the video, the audio is locked to it. If I cut the video by pressing K, the audio will get cut as well. But since I don't have the auto select children or auto delete children, if I were to grab this video strip and move it, the audio strip moves above this previous audio strip only because it was not selected. To show you what I mean by this, if I move this back here, select both of them by holding shift and clicking on both, and then grab them, you'll notice that it doesn't move. And then if I delete, the audio remains. But if I enable the auto delete children and delete this parent, it deletes it. To parent a strip to another strip, the last strip selected will be considered as the active strip. So if I select this audio strip first, then this video strip, and press Control P, I now get this menu where I can set active as parent. Also, you can see if a strip already has a parent or child or children strip to it, which you can clear or select. It also has a very interesting feature, which is the quick tags. If we go right here, the quick tags is available both up here and down here. These are pretty much the same menus, except that when you separate these two editors, some of their options are also separated. If we go into the quick tags, if I select this strip right here, the second part of my video, I write a name, I would say second half, and hit the plus button. This now has been tagged. Let's say I select this strip. If I click on the tag, the strip gets selected. You can also clear selected tags and see which tags are currently active. When I select it, it's active right here. And you can just as easily delete a tag. We then have quick fades, which is done using the F keyboard shortcut. If we go in here and I were to say that I want this to fade out, simply click on this strip, press F, set the fade length, which works in frames. So you might want to take into consideration your frame rate when setting this up. But let's say I want a 15 frames fade out, then press F again, set fade out, and it's already done. Refresh sequencer, and there you have it, a 15 frames fade out. If you'd like to clear this fade out real quick, you can go to edit strip, right click on the property that has been keyed, and clear keyframes. Set it back. There we go. We also get a few other options, as you can see. It lets us know if there are any fade in or fade outs that are detected. You can crossfade two strips, so you get different options. Then we have the quick cuts. The quick cuts is done using the Alt K keyboard shortcut. By holding Alt and pressing K, we now get these options right here. You can also access these properties here in your side menus or your properties menu. So we have the quick cuts, which also allows you, see we made a cut here earlier. Using the quick cuts, I can actually uncut to the left. Now as you can see, it has uncut it. And you can also do this with audio tracks. So if I go to quick cuts and uncut left, all right. The quick markers is similar to the tags. So it keeps track of the different markers that you add to your marker list. And by clicking on it, your cursor, the sequencer cursor, will jump to that marker. Quite useful. These are some very useful add-ons right here. All right, you can keep exploring this, dive deeper. Now, last but not least, certainly not least, a well-needed add-on for Blender is the Kinera tool. As I said, this comes by default with Blender 2.79. So first off, we have the jump to cut panel, which is a feature that I do not personally use, so I won't be getting too much into it. But basically what this does is it compacts many of the other features that you already have, the properties that you have, and puts them here neatly for you in this little panel. So if I expand this all the way here, drag this up a bit. Now, if you were to use this add-on, you'd probably want to have a different layout for your display in order to access this more easily. In this case, you would want to use the 2-in-1 sequencer and image preview, which you can set up very quickly. But yes, this technically gives you the same features that you already have, but all in one compact space. As I said, I do not personally use it, but you can also read about it on the add-ons documentation by clicking right here on documentation. Before we move on to the Echo Tools panel, let's have a quick look at the hotkeys that are enabled or activated with the Kinera tools. Now, it is important to note that this right here, skip 1 second forward or skip 1 second backward, is in direct relation to your frame rate. If your frame rate was set to 24 frames per second, then your cursor would move 24 frames back or 24 frames forward. If you're set to 29.97 as I am, it will move to that amount of frames. You can set your in-source, out-source, you can jump to previous markers by using the Shift Q and Shift W, or jump to previous strips using the Q and W. With that said, also in the VSC Quick Functions, if you use the S keyboard shortcut right here, you get these options right here, the quick snaps, selected to cursor, sequence to beginning of cursor, or you can use the keyboard shortcut in some cases, which is the Shift S, to snap your active sequence to the cursor. Back to the Kinera tool, the Echo Tools panel. Now the Echo Tools is an interesting feature because it allows you to add motion blur to your sequences inside of the video sequencer editor. Up here in the properties panel, you might notice that you have a sampled motion blur, but this does not apply for the sequencer. So you can't add motion blur to a video strip or image strip directly from here, but thanks to the add-on, the Kinera tool, you can. Now here's how you use it. You first need to group the strip that you would like to add motion blur to. To do so, you can go down here in strip and go up to make meta strip or use the keyboard shortcut Ctrl G. Only once you've turned your strip into a meta strip will the echo tool option show up. Now the echoes is referring to the amount of images or blur frames that will be created, and the offset refers to the amount of frames in between each echo. Now to illustrate this, let's go ahead and use the echo operator. Since we have the echoes set to 5, you'll notice it jumped up to channel 6, which we can see if we go up here, we're now on channel 6. I'll show you why and how this works right now. So with my new meta strip selected, I'll press tab to go inside of it, and you'll notice that our original meta strip was duplicated 5 times, but they were moved to the side because of this audio strip. Now let's press tab to get out of this. With no strip selected, press tab. All right, now to work around this, what I'll do first is I'll go back into my meta strip. I'll delete these strips. What you can do, Alt G to ungroup. What you can do is either move this audio strip under this video strip, or you can press tab to go inside of this meta strip right here. Grab this strip and meta it again, which means Ctrl G, and now you apply your echoes. And there you go. Now you simply tab out of this and the echoes are applied inside of this meta. If I refresh sequence, you can now see that there's a blur right here. It added 3 frames or 3 echoes. The way this works is if we tab into it, then tab into this one, it simply duplicates your original footage and overlays it over its own self and offsetting it by 1 frame. This top one is offsetted from this lower one by 1 frame, and this upper one is offsetted to this lower one by 1 frame, and so on. Also, it's important to note that the Echo 2 is quite CPU intensive, obviously, since it's duplicating your footage so many times and simply playing with their opacity. If you go to edit strip, you can see it right here. It lowers the opacity of the echoes. Tab out of this. With nothing selected, press tab to get out. Nothing selected again, press tab. And there you have it. So it is, now I would like to note that this doesn't give the greatest result because it doesn't admit subframes. As you can see, this is limited to frames per second, 1 frame at a time. So you can't do 0.5 frames as you would be able to right here in the motion blur. But this can be quite useful if one were to use it with motion graphics, I suppose. And for subtle blur, not the best result. But as I said, this could be used for motion graphics or something in that style. Looking at this, I could have used this. Now, we also have the tools with external dependencies and experimental. I won't be covering these because some of these only work in Linux. You have the experimental one, and most of these depend on external programs. The audio tools panel, for example, only works on Linux, and I'll show you how to do this in a future episode. Alright, that's it for today's episode. Feel free to explore and read the documentations on each of these add-ons, and go ahead and use them and discover them for yourself. These are very useful and have helped me quite a lot in my workflow when using Blender as a video editor. I did not go over all of their features. They do have many more features that I'll be covering later in the series, but these are the 3 main add-ons that I recommend getting for Blender as a video editor. Now, here is the add-on that I was mentioning earlier. This is the Easy Login 2.0 for Blender. This is quite an interesting add-on, actually. I won't be covering it, but here is their website. You can see it. It's easylogin.net. That's it for today's video. If you liked it or learned anything new today, make sure to give it a thumbs up. If you didn't, there is a thumbs down option, but who clicks on that? Also, if you're new here, make sure to subscribe and hit that little bell button so that you get notified when we release our next episode. Again, my name is Jonathan. This is NuxTux Entertainment, and I'll see you next time.